Och som tur väl så har vi en dag till tillsammans. Vi kommer börja dagen med att prata om hållbarhet och långsiktiga effekter i den digitala transformationen för museibranschen. Det blir sedan möjlighet till lunchchatt i små grupper för er som har anmält er till det.
Ja, och efter lunchen då ställer vi er inför två tuffa val, för då blir det ju som nämnt parallella spår. Där ni i det första passet kan välja mellan att antingen delta på att nå längre och möta andra på andra sätt om museer som har arbetat strategiskt med webben. Eller så kan ni gå på publika möten med fysisk distans, hur vi kan ta emot besökare på ett säkert sätt. I vårt andra valbara pass så väljer ni mellan museum plus näringsliv är lika med sant frågetecken. Om hur museer och företag kan hitta hållbara former för samverkan i framtiden. Eller så går ni och tar del av erfarenheter från ett utvecklingsprojekt där man har använt projektionsteknik för att ge liv åt museipedagogernas berättelse. Men först alltså, programpunkten i det långa loppet. Ett panelsamtal där vi kommer få höra mer om långsiktiga effekter som museerna som satsar på olika digitala verktyg och strategier kan förvänta sig.
Ja, under coronapandemin har ju allt fler institutioner utnyttjat möjligheten att nå sina målgrupper genom digitala kanaler och aktiviteter. Nu är frågan hur dessa förändrade arbetssätt kan bli permanenta och bli en del av institutionens strategiska och långsiktiga arbete. Temat är hållbarhet och vi kommer att möta aktörer med mångårig erfarenhet av digital transformation. Samtalsledare är Larissa Bork från Riksantikvarieämbetet. Hon kommer att presentera sig själv och sin panel. Välkommen Larissa.
Tack. Hej och tack Jeanette och Erik för inledningen till museimötets andra dag. Jag heter Larissa Bork. Jag jobbar på Riksantikvarieämbetet med den digitala infrastrukturen KOSAM-SÖK. Och jag ser jättefram emot den här sessionen i det långa loppet, hållbarhet och långsiktiga effekter i den digitala transformationen. Under de senaste månaderna har museivärlden upplevt en tydlig ökning av digitala utbud. Nytt innehåll till sociala medier har producerats och nya format som appar och tematiska webbsidor har skapats. Många kunder även återanvänder material från tidigare kampanjer och projekt. Och museimedarbetare i hela landet har jobbat hårt för att ställa om verksamheten och att ändå tillgängliggöra museiupplevelser till publiken. Men gör en app skillnad? Förändrar en digital utställning eller kampanj förhållandet mellan museet och publiken? Nej, det tror jag inte. Den digitala transformationen handlar om mer än enstaka digitala kanaler, medier eller upplevelser. Den förändrar hur vi tänker kring museer som institutioner och påverkar såväl våra aktiviteter i det digitala området som på plats. Det påverkar alla våra verksamhetsområden, från förmedlingen om utställningarna till tillgången till samlingarna. Och värderingarna som användarna känner från digitala kanaler och medier tillämpas på kultursektorn. Man förväntar sig snabba reaktioner, öppenhet och ett utbud som anpassar sig till olika målgruppers behov och intressen på nätet och i själva museibyggnaden. I intervjuer som jag gjort de senaste veckorna med museer i Europa och USA om omställningen till digitala arbets- och förmedlingssätt var museernas uppdrag en stor drivkraft. De flesta museerna förstår kontakten med sina prioriterade målgrupper samt deras intressen och behov som ett av museernas huvudsyfte. En deltagare beskrev att tiden som deras museum har varit stängt faktiskt ledde till en ny uppfattning om digitala kanaler. Det uppfattas inte längre bara som en marknadsföringskanal för att locka folk till det fysiska museet, men som en plattform för en förmedling där man kan möta publiken och tillgängliggöra sina samlingar. Det är en otroligt central punkt i den digitala transformationen att förstå det digitala och fysiska som lika värdefulla i att uppnå våra institutionernas mål och missioner. Samtidigt har olika plattformar såklart olika krav och förutsättningar. Jag citerar från en intervju med Jane Alexander från Cleveland Museum of Art. During the first few weeks, we needed to create experiences for the online platform rather than just moving existing programming online. There was a learning curve. The first video we posted from home was formatted like an exhibition lecture. When considering what our audiences from home actually wanted, we changed our format. Detta beskriver exakt processen som kulturarvssektorn behöver ta sig igenom. Vi får inte bara digitalisera utbudet som vi har skapat för de fysiska områdena. Vi behöver tänka om och tänka utifrån digitala användningssätt och vanor. Vi behöver värdera den digitala besökaren samt sina behov och intressen lika högt som den analoga. I den här tiden, fortfarande mitt i pandemin, behöver vi som kulturarvsaktörer fråga oss själva. Hur kan förändringarna som vi har upplevt de senaste månaderna och som redan har varit ett stort och intensivt steg för många bli en riktig transformation? Hur kan vi uppnå hållbara och mätbara effekter genom att göra våra nuvarande förändrade arbetssätten till en permanent del av våra institutioners strategiska och långsiktiga arbete? I denna session kommer vi att diskutera olika verksamhetsområden och perspektiv från museer och organisationer som har tagit steg från projektbaserade tidsbegränsade aktiviteter till långsiktiga investeringar i kunskap och teknik. Tillsammans med våra gäster ska vi diskutera vilken skillnad mångåriga strategiska satsningar på digital infrastruktur kan göra och kanske har gjort, speciellt under covid-19-pandemin. Jag är jätteglad att presentera våra gäster idag. Välkomna Aron Ambrosiani från Nordiska museet, Chao Tayana från African Digital Heritage i Nairobi, Jonas Heide-Smith från Statens museum för kunst i Köpenhamn samt Karin Nilsson från Statens historiska museer. De ska först presentera sina institutioner och organisationers arbete i korta föredrag. Mellan presentationerna har vi lite tid för några korta frågor. Och ni får gärna ställa era frågor i chatten, på Zoom eller YouTube. Efter presentationerna ska vi tillsammans diskutera olika synpunkter kring hållbarhet och långsiktiga effekter i den digitala transformationen. Och nu välkomnar jag först på den här digitala scenen Jonas Heide-Smith. Jonas is joining us today from Copenhagen, Denmark, where he works as head of digital at the Statens Museum for Kunst, the Danish National Gallery. He's responsible for their communication and brand development and is an expert in the realm of digital communication strategies and user experience and interaction design. In his talk, he will focus on finding the right balance between creating interfaces for users and investing in infrastructure. Welcome, Jonas.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Should I give a short presentation of where I'm from? I had some sound problems, so...
That was just Swedish, Jonas.
Can you repeat the introduction? I'm just, I was off for a second.
We are welcoming Jonas from Statens Museum for Kunst in Köpenhamn. He's the head of digital at the Danish National Gallery and is an expert in the realm of digital communication strategies and user experience and interaction design. In his talk, he will focus on finding the optimal balance between creating interfaces for the public and investing in infrastructure.
That's very
fair. Go ahead, Jonas.
Thank you. So here we go. Thanks a lot for the invitation. As Larissa said, I am head of digital at SMK in Copenhagen. And I'll be doing this in English, so I'll spare you my weird Danish-Swedish hybrid. I'm responsible for making sure our digital setup at the museum makes sense, both for guests and for ourselves. And lately I've had some time to think about things, not because of the lockdown, but because I went on parental leave on the very first day of lockdown. And I came back 1 month after reopening a very strange experience. So at the very moment where digital really flourished, I wasn't here, which is kind of ironic. But I've been thinking about crisis. What do they mean? What can we learn? And I'm really not in the everything has changed forever camp. But I do think that this massive sudden change tells us something really interesting about ourselves. That's what I want to explain here in my talk. Now, let me just share my screen. Let's say you're a museum manager and you have some kind of budget, hopefully. You can spend that money on two general things. You can either spend it on improving day-to-day operations, or the day-to-day operations would be stuff like making sure the museum is clean and the light works and all these things. But you can also spend your time and money on investments, obviously. And I think there are three important categories. You can invest in skills of your staff members, or your access to skills, competencies. You can invest your time in strategy. You can spend time thinking really hard about what your museum's purpose is. You can have those goals very clearly stated. It really helps you when you have to change course because you know what you're actually about. So I think time invested in strategy is time well spent in this sense. And then you can invest in systems. You can invest in what we can call sort of the machinery of the museum, and all these things represent investments, obviously, in infrastructure, in sort of the behind the scenes of your museum. So. Just to exemplify, let me tell you a little bit about the SMK infrastructure. We have lots of systems. This is a very confusing and annoying slide, I'm sorry. It's just to tell you that there are many systems. In an ideal world, on a good day, they work together to create a kind of seamless, elegant infrastructure that enables lots of things to happen. It's a kind of a super system, right? The system I've been most involved with at SMK is the, recently at least, is the SMK API. So this is the SMK data delivery system. It takes all our collection data, all our images and so forth, and makes that data usable by anyone. And so that's really not operations at all. It's very far from operations, but it allows for flexibility. And it's not directly tied to any particular context or any kind of reality. Very much unlike that other interface to our collection, the SMK main building, the original interface, the previous interface that people used to think of as the museum, which is very much tied to one concrete reality or context. Now, I would like you to think about your own museums. Are you a operations heavy, a front end heavy museum? Are you a back end leaning museum? Where do you prioritize? Where do you put those? Where do you put that budget? Because it's very possible to do both. And just to be clear, well, here's an example. Is this what you like? You like interesting user oriented front ends? That give people beautiful experiences of the museum, digital or analog, or do you prefer something like this? This is the back end heavy museum, right? This is where you nurse your metadata, your databases. You make sure everything works on the back end. So these are the two kinds of types of museum you can kind of be. You can be front end leaning or it could be back end leaning. And the point, of course, is not to be either or. It's not to be either front-end operations or back-end systems. But the problem here is, how do you prioritize? And yes, it's obviously a balance between those two. And if you're a manager who's not in digital or who's not in IT, you probably can't really tell very well. And the problem is, if you have too much front end and you don't invest in your back end or in your systems, everything becomes expensive and it becomes unstable. If you have too much back end, no one sees your work, right? If you only do the databases and you only do the archives and you only do the metadata, nobody's going to experience it, and that is not very good either. So again, it's a balance. But how can you tell which one you are right now? I think it's practically impossible. You probably can't tell if you're a manager of a museum, unless you're very technical, because you're not going to be able to see how the machine actually performs. How well do your systems work together? How well are they integrated? Normally, pre-corona, pre-crisis, on a normal day, you're probably not able to tell very well. You can maybe sense it by considering how much double work your staff does, how much triple work, quadruple work do you do. The more you do, the less sensible your infrastructure is. But right now, I think there's a specific moment where you can actually tell much better than usually, because having a sensible, well-functioning backend system and infrastructure makes you able to handle change or crisis much better. So I think right now is the moment of truth. How well were you able to adapt to something completely new? If that was very, very difficult for you, impossible for you, then you probably didn't invest enough in the infrastructure, in the backend, in the systems, in the strategy, and the skills. If it was relatively doable for you, you probably have a much more robust setup that can actually encompass change, crisis, new lockdowns, new pandemics, all these things. So I think what really happens now is that museums will take this opportunity, or they should take this opportunity, to rethink their balance between front-end and back-end, between operations and investments, to prepare for future crises. This is the moment where we can actually see how prepared we are. And if we were not prepared for this one, we're not going to be prepared for the next one. This is the time to rethink the balance and invest in infrastructure. So thank you and good luck.
Thank you, Jonas, for your presentation. That was really inspiring, and I really like the focus on that we don't actually should focus on shiny new things, but also invest in back and projects. I have a question, because you talked about how managers might not even know if their systems are running efficiently. What do you think? What kind of skill sets or knowledge do managers need in the museum sector for the future to actually be being able to lead their museums into a digital future?
Well, ideally, managers would have a complete and deep insight into all aspects of the museum. That's probably not realistic. So managers, I think, should focus on the same old virtues. They have to hire, they have to have the competency to hire the right people to do this. They hire the right people is the manager's ultimate responsibility, right? Because you're not going to be able to understand the intricacies of the integrations between the systems necessarily on a deep, deep level. But you need to hire people who can do this. And of course, you need to hire people or to have a context at the museum where your head of IT or head of digital is able to communicate these things and say, we need to improve our infrastructure to make things work better. Then you need to be able to trust that person, right? So it's not about placing a huge burden of technical understanding on everybody, but it's about understanding this area and being able to interpret the signs, double work, triple work, all these things, that it doesn't really work, and to enter into dialogue with the people who are actually sort of setting up and running the machine.
Thank you. What do you think do we in the museum sector and even on in conferences like this one focus too much on shiny projects such as AI apps or new museum platforms and don't speak about the back end often enough?
There are different worlds in museums. I'm in communications. We talk a lot about front ends. People in other departments, they talk too much about the back end, right? I have met people who forgot about the front end. The money ran out before they got to the front end. That happens as well. So it's very hard to say generally. These things ideally should, as I said, be a balance. And there are museums who place too much focus on either one. But of course, the traditional issue has been that front-end has been exponentially more fundable than back-end, and it probably still is. It's much easier to attract, it has been much easier to attract funding for a website, an app, an audience-facing system, than it has to clean up your metadata, or to build an internal system of image management. Very few will want to fund that. So if you're externally funded in that sense, it becomes a tough challenge to phrase your investments as something that will benefit the audience. But that's been probably your job.
Thank you so much, Jonas. I'm really sure we are going to take up business models and funding later in the discussion. But thank you so much so far. Och nu välkomnar jag vår gäst direkt här från Nordiska museet, Aron Ambrosiani. Aron är producent för digitala medier på Nordiska museet och jobbar med museets digitala interaktion, både på plats här i museet och utanför museets väggar. I hans föredrag ska han fokusera på Nordiska museets insamlingskampanjer och den tillhörande infrastrukturen. Välkommen Aron.
Så mycket. Jag tänkte, om vi jämför med Jonas inlägg nu, så tänkte jag kanske ge ett mer konkret exempel på hur den här digitala infrastrukturarbetet kan komma till hjälp under en snabb omställning. Tänkte att jag ska dela min skärm, så ska vi se hur det går. Så. Kanske även så här. Så jag ska prata om digital insamling under våren 2020. Coronaviruset i Sverige och mitt liv. Det här är alltså namnet på två digitala insamlingar som vi har genomfört och genomför på Nordiska museet. Men först kanske vi ska återvända då till slutet av februari, början av mars 2020, när det blev mer uppenbart att coronaviruset var inte bara en utrikesangelägenhet, utan det var någonting som ägde rum i Sverige och blev en del av svensk vardag. Från den 26 februari och framåt började dagliga smittfall att förekomma i Sverige. Det bekräftades dagligen ny smitta av coronavirus. Den 9 mars, några veckor senare, misstänktes den första inhemska smittan. Det vill säga att det inte längre bara var folk som återvände hem från utlandet och hade smittats där. Den 11 mars bekräftades det första dödsfallet i Sverige i corona. Så det här är ju under några veckor där det plötsligt skjuter fart, alla kurvorna pekade uppåt och ingen visste riktigt hur det här skulle påverka Sverige eller världen. Men det var tydligt att det skulle göra det. Och det ville vi ju såklart då dokumentera på något sätt. Vi valde att göra det i form av en digital insamling som lades ut på plattformen minnen.se. Där vem som helst då kunde gå in och besvara några frågor om hur deras vardag hade påverkats. Vad de tänkte om tillståndet i samhället nu och hur de såg på framtiden. För att försöka fånga den här osäkerheten kring hur världen höll på att förändras. Det här gjorde vi digitalt då på den här plattformen. Det var inte bara vi, vill jag påpeka, utan det var ju många svenska museer som valde att på olika sätt dokumentera och bevara den här begynnande coronapandemin. Runt om i Sverige startades ett 30-tal insamlingar, digitala insamlingar. De flesta i form av enkäter där svaren skickades in till ett museum eller arkiv och sen hamnade hos arkivet eller museet och inte visades för allmänheten. Till skillnad då från insamlingen på Nordiska museet. I vårt fall så kunde vi lansera den här insamlingen den 18 mars. Det vill säga ganska kort efter att coronapandemin då tog fart i Sverige. Vår projektledare för digital insamling, Jörgen Löwenfelt, var ansvarig och kunde då prata ihop sig med arkiv, IT, digital interaktion, de olika, och kommunikation såklart, de olika aktörer på museet som behövde vara med och utforma ett sånt här snabbt projekt. Det plockades upp av TT och dagstidningar och andra medier och tog snabbt fart. På bara några dagar hade vi 750 insamlade svar. Det innebar i sin tur att det började bli väldigt svårt att överblicka de här svaren för publiken. Och då kunde vi ge med hjälp av Albin Larsson, en konsult som tidigare arbetat på Riksantikvarieämbetet, så kunde vi ta fram en visualisering av de inlämnade svaren. Och det byggde också på att jag under ett tidigare projekt på Nordiska museet arbetat just med digitala kartor. Så då kunde vi, ska se, först några exempel här på de här berättelserna som då lämnades in snabbt när insamlingen drog igång, den 19 mars. Jag kan inte gå ut själv. Mina föräldrar och min pojkvän handlar mat åt mig och lämnar vid min dörr. Jag orkar knappt laga någon mat, så det blir mycket Ben & Jerry's som är skönt mot febern. Turkisk yoghurt, soppa och färdig fryspizza. Jessica Ekström, född 1995, har bidragit med den här berättelsen och fotot. Och det här är ju då inte hela det inlämnade svaret såklart. Ett annat fint exempel är det här, 19 mars också. Under min och min sambos tid i karantän får vi reda på att hon är gravid. Jag ska bli pappa. Medan världen tycks falla sönder och samman svävar jag som på moln. Och här är en anonym inlämnare, ER, född 1989. Med också en väldigt stilig skyddsmask i bild där. Så det här är två exempel på inlämnade berättelser. Men det kan som sagt bli svårt att klicka sig runt i en lista på hundratals svar. Så det vi då kunde göra var en karta som då med hjälp av den här dels det som jag har hunnit lära mig under tidigare projekt och med hjälp av Albin Larssons kompetens kunde vi göra den här kartan på bara 3 dagar från idé till färdig publicerad på vår hemsida. Och den, i och med det här geografiska perspektivet, så blev den väldigt tacksam för nyhetsredaktioner lokalt som då kunde lyfta och visa att Nordiska museet bevarade berättelser från just den plats som man ville nämna. Så här såg det ut på webbstatistiken för den här insamlingen. Som ni ser så är det, den första puckeln där är de dagar insamlingen publicerades, 18, 19, 20 mars. Och sen höll intresset i sig på en ganska jämn nivå ungefär fram till påskhelgen. Det är ju också då de dagliga dödsfallen i Sverige av corona nådde sin första topp och sen dalade det som tur var neråt. Och det jag vill visa med den här statistiken är ju att fönstret för att dokumentera och samla in här, det var ganska kort. Vi hade ungefär en månad av medialt intresse för den här pandemin, som sen helt klart övergick i en annan fas när andra frågor återigen kunde bryta igenom mediebruset. Och då försvann också allmänhetens intresse av att bidra till våra insamlingar. Så man har inte så lång tid på sig när det är något som händer i omvärlden. Som museum är vi vana vid och tycker om att jobba lite långsammare än så. Men när det gäller den här typen av digitala insatser, då gäller det att vara med direkt. Hur ska man då vara med direkt? Och det är ju där vi kommer till den här frågan om hållbarhet och lite längre processer, framförallt kring digital infrastruktur. Det här är en bild från Nordiska museets frågelista nummer 10. Så en av de allra första, när museet började ställa frågor till allmänheten och samla in svar. I det här fallet om virke och virkesbehandling från 1929. Det är en i Blekinge välkänd berättare, August Holmberg, som har ritat av hur det gick till när man kvistade av skogsträna. Vad har det här med digital insamling att göra? Jo, det löper ju förstås en linje från den här frågelistverksamheten, som då var väldigt analog, med brev som skickades ut runt i landet, varpå meddelarna gick runt i bygden, intervjuade och skrev egna brev som de skickade tillbaka. Från det i riktning då mot en digital insamlingsplattform. Men den jobbade vi också ett antal år med för att den skulle finnas redo att lanseras på några få dagar när det var dags för att göra en insamling om corona. Så kallad rapid response collecting, snabb krisdokumentation skulle man kanske kunna översätta det till på svenska. Det har Nordiska museet testat och utvärderat och förbättrat sedan 2017 i form av ett inom ramarna för ett forskningsprojekt som Kajsa Hartig, som tidigare jobbade på Nordiska museet, var ansvarig för. Så på så sätt kunde vi i flera omgångar fundera på och lära oss hur vi skulle samla in i just de här snabba förändringarnas tid. För att kunna göra det behövde vi en plattform för digital insamling. Den har vi tillsammans med Kultur-IT och Norsk Folkemuseum utvecklat, och flera andra samarbetspartner, utvecklat sedan 2015. Så det är alltså 5 års arbete som ligger bakom för att kunna ha den här plattformen redo när man på några dagars varsel vill dra igång en insamling. Att den plattformen finns på plats under utveckling sedan 2015 bygger i sin tur på att Nordiska museet har haft en digital avdelning, en först kallad nya medier, numera digital interaktion, igång sedan 2011. Så att vi har haft dedikerad personal för att testa, utveckla och pröva digitala metoder, processer och verktyg. Så som Jonas beskrev det, att kunna sätta av tid till strategiutveckling och teknisk utveckling. En sista slide innan jag lämnar tillbaka till Larissa. Att den här coronavirusinsamlingen fick stort genomslag innebar också att vi fick draghjälp då. Så fungerar det i digitala medier. Att när det första går bra så finns intresset kvar på sajten. Och det har då hjälpt oss i nästa insamling där skolelever dokumenterar sin vardag. Det här är en upprepning eller en andra omgång av en insamling från 1942. Då också mitt under en brinnande kris, nämligen andra världskriget. När Nordiska museet tillsammans med skolradion dokumenterade skolelevernas vardag. Nu gör vi samma sak igen tillsammans med utbildningsradion. Och den insamlingen fortsätter även nu under hösten och de närmsta åren. Tack så mycket. Där lämnar jag tillbaka till Larissa.
Tack så mycket Aron för att ge oss lite insyn i eras insamlingskampanjerna. Jag är jätteintresserad faktiskt av något som du sa, att man måste vara snabbt att insamla berättelser kring till exempel katastrofer eller i den här fallen kriser som händer. Kan du berätta lite mer om hur du ser museer i den här omvärlden också i sociala medier? Var folk vill faktiskt bidra med sina berättelser och vill ha någon aktör, en seriös aktör som lyssnar på nätet?
Jag tror två saker. Dels så är ju alla på nätet är numera sen kanske 10 år tillbaka vana vid att det de gör syns direkt. Det är ju så det är sen sociala medier och framåt. Kanske till och med ett antal år där innan med bloggar, även om det ju var en mera nischad erfarenhet. Men numera förväntar sig allmänheten att det de gör eller det de lämnar in till ett museum, att det syns direkt. Det kanske inte var så man tänkte för 20 år sedan, men nu är det definitivt så. Så där tror jag verkligen att våra plattformar och vårt beteende på nätet måste följa det. Att vi blir mera öppna med vad vi tar emot. Och det som jag också tycker är tydligt från de här insamlingarna, de digitala insamlingarna som Nordiska museet har gjort de senaste 5 åren då, det är att det måste vara tydligt för besökaren eller deltagaren vad som är poängen med att bidra med sitt svar. Och där kan det vara olika saker. Det kan vara att vara del av att dokumentera något som uppenbarligen är ett avtryck i historien, som den här coronapandemin. Hur var det egentligen? Tror vi nu att folk kommer fråga om 50 år? Det kanske inte är så. Det kanske blåste över och var något annat som var betydligt värre som skäl fokus när man ska prata om 2020-talet. Men just nu så tror vi att det här kommer vara något för framtiden. Och det gör i sig att folk vill bidra med sina berättelser. Det andra som fungerar är när museet så att säga använder sin auktoritet som vi har byggt upp som kunskapsinstitution. När vi visar att något är viktigt och att då kan besökare eller användare eller deltagare vara med och bekräfta. Vi gjorde till exempel en insamling om personliga hemsidor på 90-talet där det var tydligt att de här personerna som hade gjort en hemsida på 90-talet, de blev glada när det betraktades som en viktig milstolpe i internetutvecklingen. Och därför så ville de bidra med sina berättelser för att på något sätt stärka legitimiteten för just den här kreativa uttrycksformen. Så när det blir ett samspel med deltagarna eller användarna, då fungerar de digitala insamlingarna.
Tack. Nu har jag även en fråga om användning av dessa berättelser. För att en stor skillnad för mig är ju att tidigare när ni har insamlat berättelser, då var det att de typ försvann bakom kulisserna och museet själv hade bara tag på dem. Men nu att man publicerar dem på minnen.se eller andra plattformar är det ju så, och oftast med öppna licenser. Då är det oftast så att även andra utanför museet kan använda dessa berättelser. Vad tänker du kring det?
Där tänker vi att det liknar beteendet på sociala medier. Även om vi kanske har en mera uttryckt licensmedgivande, så är det ju som andra saker på nätet att det bygger på något sätt på att det ska gå att dela och sprida vidare och ta del av berättelserna. Och där känner ju vi att de här berättelserna tillhör ju, det kanske inte är att betrakta som museets egna samling. Vi tar hand om dem, men det är i första hand personerna själva som står för innehållet. Och som komplement då, i och med att många berättelser kanske man inte vill dela med sig av till omvärlden, om det kan vara ett känsligare ämne och så vidare. så erbjuder vi då förstås också möjligheten att lämna in bara till forskning, det vill säga i stil med så som museer har samlat tidigare och fortfarande gör på många ställen såklart.
Tack så mycket Aron. Det var jätteinspirerande och spännande. Och jag ser fram emot att diskutera dessa ämnen vidare i diskussion med dig och de andra. So our next guest joining us from Nairobi, Kenya is Chao Tayana. Chao is a digital heritage specialist and a digital humanities scholar. With a background in computer science, her work primarily focuses on the application of technology in the preservation, engagement and dissemination of African culture and heritage. Furthermore, she is the founder of the Kenya-based non-profit organization African Digital Heritage and initiatives such as the Museum of British Colonialism. In her talk, she will focus on the investment in one of the central infrastructures of digitization, knowledge and skills. Hi, Chao.
Hi, Larissa. Thank you for the wonderful introduction and thank you to everyone who's attending today. If you'll allow me to share my screen, and I can begin my presentation. Hello everyone again. My name is Chao Tayana. I'm based in Nairobi, Kenya, and I'm a digital heritage specialist. So in this discussion, I'll be talking about digital skills in Kenya's cultural heritage sector, but particularly looking at different perspectives on digital heritage in Africa. So before I begin looking at the question of skills in particular, I'll start with issues around legacy and the foundation generally of many museums here in Africa. And this is a quote that I got from an established museum professional in Nigeria who was looking at the legacies of African museums and how they began and why we have such a complex relationship to museums. And if you look at the history of most, I'd say public museums, national museums on the continent, most of them were started as imperial societies. So either by the British, by the French, by the Germans, but they were mostly established to observe African people, to observe their culture, to satisfy this curiosity of tribal people per se. And what this did is that it excluded local populations. It excluded the people who are making the objects. It excluded us from the museum as an institution. So after independence, many of these museums were turned into national museums, let's say the National Museum of Kenya, of Nigeria, of Namibia, and so forth. But what happens is because of the legacy of colonialism and imperialism, these museums were never able to relate to the public. And I think African audiences in general have had a very hard time establishing a relationship with museums, but also seeing the museums as spaces that work for us, that accommodate us, that listen to us. So when we look at these foundations and we look at the digital age, a few questions emerge. In a sector that has been, as I had said, founded on exclusion, bias, and a disregard for indigenous knowledge, we start to ask, how do we use technology, particularly digital technology, to dismantle these structures and redefine what museums mean to us as Africans, how we relate to them? Are they spaces that speak to us? Are they spaces that accommodate our indigenous knowledge? Are they spaces where we can be active participants? And for me, the question of democratization, which is often comes hand in hand with digital, I think is a very interesting question, because when we look at digital being a democratic space, we have to ask questions. We have to ask, is it really a democratic space? Because the same structures of inequality and privilege and bias that exist in the physical world can be replicated in the digital world. So as we begin even to look at the space of digital technologies within African heritage, we need to be aware that some of the manifestations that we see in the physical world that are detaching audiences, that are excluding people, do have the potential to be replicated in the digital world. And when we look at particularly the digital space, online space, social media, vlogs, channels, and we look at who is doing the work of curating African heritage versus who can do the work. So in the next few slides, I'm going to show you a few examples of people who are curating African heritage in different parts of the continent, and then go into the question of skills. So when I ask who is doing the work, I'll give you a few examples. On social media in Kenya, there's a community called History Kenya that's run by a private group of individuals who have full-time jobs, who are working in the evenings and on the weekends to curate African history, particularly Kenyan history. So if you look at History Kenya, they're on Facebook, they're on Twitter, they're on Instagram. They have an audience of more than 162,000 people across different social media platforms. And you can imagine when content is retweeted, it is shared, how much further it will go. But you look at a group like History Kenya, these are private individuals, often who are doing this on a voluntary basis. But look at the amount of the audience reach that they have. And then we begin to ask questions. Well, if this work is being done in the private space, what is happening in the public sector? What is happening with the national museums? Who is actually being the voice of Kenya's history or the custodian? A second example is a platform called History in Progress in Uganda, which is a private initiative that encourages people to digitize private photos in their collections and share them online. On Facebook alone, they have an audience of 20,000 people. Another example is in Zambia. We head down to Zambia where we see a podcast series, an animated podcast series on YouTube that has a reach of over 90,000 views in just less than 2 years. So these numbers are astounding, even according to physical museum visits. If you look at the physical museum visits that let's say museums in Kenya, Zambia, or Uganda receive, they are much less than the numbers that we are seeing online. So we begin to see that there's a very big gap between what is happening in the private space versus what is happening in the public space. Another example that I'll give is the Museum of British Colonialism Initiative, which is a purely online museum started by a group of volunteers in Kenya and the UK, including myself, who work to explore inclusive ways of communicating British colonial history. And the impetus for starting the Museum of British Colonialism was a realization that whether you're in Kenya or the UK, the version of colonialism that we knew was very watered down, very abstract, and it was not reflective of what actually happened. So when I speak to my grandfather about colonialism in Kenya, and when I go back to my history books in primary school, in secondary school, they are very different stories. So for us, it was a big issue that we were not able even to understand what the impact and what had taken place during colonialism based on the sources that are there. And we began to challenge this and say, as an online space, as people who are online, as a younger generation, how can we use digital media to communicate an alternative, but also very inclusive form of colonial history? And one of our key projects with the Museum of British Colonialism has been to look at creating digital reconstructions, 3D visualizations of detention camps that were set up by the British in Kenya. Now, if you can see here, we have an archival image on the right, at the center. And this is a camp, a detention camp, sort of like a concentration camp that was set up by the British during the colonial period here in Kenya. But these camps are no longer there. Many of them were destroyed. Many of them were turned into private property, and the archives were shipped to the UK. So as Kenyans, we have very little access to this information, more or less knowing that these things happened in our own country. And what we've been doing is to create digital reconstructions. You can see here, and you can see one here, digital reconstructions of these camps, 3D visualizations that we're able to disseminate freely on open access to audiences, mostly in Kenya, the UK, and around the world. And that brings me to the next thing that I will talk about. You'll see clearly that a lot of the things that I have demonstrated are coming from the private sector. And last year, I was involved in a project called Skills for Culture that was looking at why is there such a big gap in terms of the representation of public institutions, public cultural institutions in Kenya? They're not online. While a lot of taxpayer money is going into these institutions, majority of the audiences online have no access to them. They have no way of talking to the museum. They have no way of accessing collections. And we started looking at the question of new entrants and new perspectives. All the people that I've shown you, the podcast in Zambia, the group in Uganda, this is what I will call new entrants. These are new perspectives that have not traditionally been there before because of barriers to access and dissemination. And what does this mean for established practitioners? What does this mean for people in the National Museums of Kenya, or let's say the National Museum of Uganda? What does it mean for them and for their audiences? But particularly, what skills emerge out of these social shifts? We're seeing a very big social shift from the institution being the core of history and the people who are disseminating history to everyone doing this work. So what skills emerge out of this social shift, and who possesses them? And we did to understand what digital skills were needed within Kenya's cultural heritage industry. We began by having an in-depth research into the landscape in Kenya. And this research, we began by asking questions such as, what are the limitations of cultural heritage in Kenya? What is its direction? What is its success? And what are the challenges? But also we asked critical questions around value, audiences, and legitimacy. How do we value cultural heritage? Where are Kenyan audiences? Are they mostly on Facebook? Are they mostly on Twitter? Are they not online? And most importantly, around legitimacy. So if I, as Chow, I'm not part of the National Museum of Kenya, do I still have a right to be talking about history online, to be sharing, to be connecting with audiences? And all these platforms that we're seeing coming up that have no connection to the establishment of cultural heritage itself, are they legitimate actors? And do public institutions accommodate them, and can they work together? And finally, we provided recommendations on which training programs can be developed to address the skills gap, depending on what we found. And our research revealed that we needed to look at digital skills in terms of four areas of intervention. The first one being documentation and preservation. So this is things like digitization, digital documentation. The second one being engagement in interpretation. So once things are digitized and documented, how do Kenyan audiences engage with them? How do they interpret them? The third one was presentation and transmission. How is this information transmitted? The digital data that is being created in National Museum, in the National Archives, how is it being transmitted? How is it being presented? And the fourth one is accessibility and reuse. And the question of accessibility and reuse, I think, is one of the most crucial things about digital skills, because we need to ask, how do we enable audiences to take the data that we've created and use it to create something else? How do they use it in films? How do they use it in games? How do they use it in schools? And much more. So we developed three core training programs. The first one was looking at audiences of the future, and it was basically looking at how to tailor content for Kenyan audiences online, mostly on social media. And we worked with the staff at the National Museum of Kenya and the National Archives to come up with ideas for content creation on social media platforms. The second one was using digital to make the most of cultural heritage assets. And this one was about digitization. It was looking at things like metadata and documenting digital data. And the third one was digitizing cultural heritage in 3D, exploring skills such as photogrammetry and so forth. Now, these training programs were delivered in the form of two-day workshops, very interactive, very face-to-face, hands-on workshops. Because what we were seeing is that when there was a lack of training in the country, most staff were either having to go to America or come to Europe to train and come back to infrastructural levels that were very different. So when you come back here, the infrastructure is different, the context is different, the audience is different, and it's very hard to apply the skills that you've learned in another context. So we said, let us try and come up with skills for the Kenyan context and see how that impacts people. And we also had a series of public audience workshops where we engaged public curators. So people such as History Kenya, saying you are a legitimate part of the industry, and how do we engage public audiences with critical skills? And over the course of 6 months, it was a pilot project. We had over 230 people attending the training in different parts of the country. Participants included museum and archive professionals and members of the public across a range of cultural venues. The training was highly valued by most, with digital skills gained, including 3D visualization, method of preservation, and expertise on using social media to build audiences. Now, this was a pilot project, and we wanted to establish, is it viable to create digital skills training programs for the Kenyan context, and what impact do they have? And what we were seeing from the engagement with staff at the museum, staff at the archives, was that most of them were very grateful to receive it, but also the fact that when the training opportunities came before, they were either left to people of higher management who would fly out of the country and come back. So the low-level staff or entry-level staff were never able to have these skills. And this was a critical, critical part of the project. So some of the lessons that we've learned, there are definitely varying infrastructural needs across the country. Museums and institutions within the city or cities, such as Nairobi and Kisumu, were better equipped than museums in let's say rural areas, and that's a very big problem in terms of digital infrastructure. The top management were not involved with in the training programs, and this was a big issue when it came to the feedback. Most of the staff said, we wish that our managers and the people who, our line managers, were in this training so that they can see the benefits of it, because they're the ones who can drive funding for this. Accessibility of content online was a very big thing, and not just accessibility of content, but also engaging with people online. There's a severe lack of funding. I'll speak in Kenya, especially for digital skills and digital heritage. Very few people are funding it. The government is not funding it. And it's very hard to find funding for this work. And there's also very minimal cross-sector interaction. So the public sector is here and the private sector is here. They're rarely connecting. And we see that once we start to bridge the gap between the private and the public sector, between private actors and public actors, between History Kenya and the National Museum of Kenya, we can be able to create new forms of interaction that are not so dependent on funding. So when it comes to digital futures for African heritage, I think there's a question of urgency versus agency. We now have the agency to expand the people who are working within cultural heritage, not just those within established institutions, but those with a passion, those who are enthusiasts. And there's also an urgency for new narratives. I think many African audiences, particularly young audiences, are tired of this narrative that Africa was backward, it was primitive. We know that there are other histories. We know that there are histories that were hidden or erased, and we want to share them. Looking at digital skills as critical skills, I think it's a very important thing, not just for practitioners, but also for audiences to have digital skills. Community participation within the digital process and within the archiving and documentation process is a big thing, I think, especially for museums in the rural areas. And as I had mentioned, looking at more private and public collaboration as a way forward, collaboration between universities and the museum, just trying to create a more interdisciplinary approach to digital heritage within Africa that is not solely depending on the museum. Like I, as a person in the private sector, I'm someone with an organization, I can attract funding, I can bring in my skills. How do I work with the museum as opposed to working on my own? So these are some of the things that I think we need to consider as we look at digital futures for African heritage, but also skills. And that's the end of my presentation in summary. But you can find more on our website, which is africandigitalheritage.com, or speak to me on Twitter if you have any additional questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Chao, for sharing your amazing work with us. I think that there were many aspects in your presentations that we are going to take up in the discussions, and I can imagine that many people in the audience also have questions, so feel free to drop them in the chat. You can also write them down in Swedish and we'll translate them. I would love to start with a question to you on the access to information. You said that in the context of your project in digitizing the camp, you find it hard to actually access information in archives, for example, in Europe. What role do you think does open access and open licenses play in this context when museums are publishing their collections online?
I think it plays a huge role, especially for museums in Europe, many of them which have a lot of ethnographic collections that are from pre-colonial Kenya or pre-colonial Africa, that those of us of a younger generation need to be able to reconstruct our past, to understand our past. And it's very frustrating for many people when we try and access these histories and they're behind paywalls. I have to go to London. And this is not to mention the fact that to get a visa is a very hard process for us. It's not something that you can wake up, go to the embassy and get a visa. You have to have bank statements, you have to have a job, you have to have a return ticket. And we look at the barriers of access to cultural information, they're extremely, extremely high. And I think open access should be a priority, especially if your museum that is possessing collections of other countries or other regions where those audiences do not even have access in their countries. So for example, I can go to the Kenya archives as much as I want, but if those records are in the UK, then there's nothing much that I can do unless they're made available online. So I would say that open access, I think it could revolutionize just how many people work within heritage. You know, it's not just a museum to museum conversation. It's a Swedish museum to Chao conversation. You could be speaking to multiple people at once. It's not just the museum in Norway communicating with the museum in Kenya. It's the museum in Norway communicating to Kenyans, you know, and we need to really lift this veil of access and institutional hierarchy.
We have a question from the audience now. How does collaborations with European museums that have collections from the African continent actually open possibilities to funding?
I think it does play a big role because if European museums are able to attract more funding, then it makes sense to collaborate with the people whose collections you have. And I know, I'm not sure if it's a museum in Sweden that is collaborating with a women's history museum in Zambia to digitize the collection, the Zambian collections, which are held in Sweden and make them accessible to people in Zambia. And I think we need to start seeing more of these collaborations in place, but also understanding that these collaborations have to happen on a very mutual understanding, that it's not just a top-down approach where European museums are talking down or advising, you know, what do the African practitioners have to say? Because this is their context. These are their audiences. They understand their collections, you know. So how does it become a dialogue instead of maybe a one-way conversation? But I think if, as European museums with access to more funding, whether it's through the EU or whether it's through private organizations, looking at ways of collaborating, because we are here, you know, there are several people like me who are working in different aspects. I've just given 3-4 examples, but there are many more in West Africa. So if there is truly a need and a wish to make these collections available, then there are partners who you can work with. And I think looking at more of those regional or rather international collaborations.
Yeah, I think the need for diverse collaborations across the museum sector is truly crucial in this context. Thank you so much, Chao, and I'm looking forward to discussing this further with you and the other guests in the discussion. Exakt, och nu, last but not least, så att säga, välkomna jag Karin Nilsson från Statens historiska museer. Karin är avdelningschef för kommunikation och digitalisering, och hon och hennes team ansvarar för att förvalta, kontextualisera och tillgängliggöra de immateriella och materiella kulturarv som ingår i myndighetens samlingar och miljöer. Karin är också ordförande i Centralmuseernas digitaliseringsråd och representerar Centralmuseerna i DigiSams beredningsgrupp. I hennes föredrag ska hon resonera om gränslandet mellan långsiktigt strukturerad digitalisering som kreativa och verksamhetsnära digitala tjänster. Välkommen Karin.
Tack så mycket Larissa. Jätteroligt att vara här. Jätteroligt att höra de inspirerande talarna före mig. Jag har jobbat med digitaliseringsfrågor i ganska många år nu, och vill man veta mer om det så har jag pratat på ganska många vårmöten och museimöten innan detta museimöte. Min kollega Malin Grundberg, som är museichef på Livrustkammaren, höll en mycket bra presentation igår också om en del av det som vi jobbar med på Statens historiska museer. Titta gärna där. Jag skulle nämligen vilja ha en lite annan infallsvinkel på det som jag vill prata om idag. Det är så, året är 2020 och vi befinner oss på ett digitalt museimöte som handlar om digitala saker. Finns det någon annan sektor som fortfarande pratar om digitalt som en särart? Jag vet inte säkert, men jag tror nästan inte det. Kan det finnas någon annan sektor som brottas med samma problem som vi? Som fortfarande till exempel skiljer mellan registrering av samlingar och digital registrering av samlingar. När H&M, Adlibris, Amazon och Wish publicerar miljontals objektsidor, var och en med ett eget föremål med beskrivande text och bild, gör de det med en hastighet som vi i museivärlden bara kan drömma om. Det skulle förvåna mig om de har samma diskussioner som vi har om vilket det exakta sakordet är eller vem som egentligen har rätt att bestämma hur ett föremål ska beskrivas. Hur går det egentligen till när Adlibris tar fram sina klassningar och beskrivningar? Hur kan de vara så snabba? När Spotify startade sin verksamhet för några år sedan gick det inte att hitta artisterna. De var dubblerade och man var tvungen att välja mellan 3 stycken Michael Jackson för att hitta rätt. Och inte ens då gick det att hitta alla låtar. Uruselt, tyckte många. Och på något år fixade Spotify ihop det som på museerna motsvarar personmoduler i sina samlingsförvaltningssystem. Så att alla Michael Jackson pekade på samma person. Systemet blev sömlöst och upplevelsen blev mycket bättre för användaren. Hur mycket resurser la de på det arbetet? Var det värt det? Ja, jag tror det. När SVT bytte fokus från tablå-tv till SVT Play blev det en tittarstorm. Hur skulle mediet kunna överleva att flyttas ut på internet? Hur skulle de kunna fylla både tablån och internet med innehåll? Hur skulle det bli med kvaliteten? Som ni vet gick det ganska bra. De kunde existera både i människors vardagsrum och i deras telefoner. Samtidigt. Naturligtvis har de här exemplen andra förutsättningar än vad vi har. De har till exempel mer pengar än vad vi i museivärlden har. Men det hade de knappast från början. Och även om de hade haft det, räcker det som förklaring. Det är dags att lyfta blicken. Under tiden som vi på museerna har tagit fram digitaliseringsstrategier funderat på om vi ska använda begreppet skanning, bildfångst eller möjligtvis digitisering och diskuterat om vi verkligen har tid att arbeta digitalt och om det verkligen är säkert att ha möten på Teams så har resten av världen förändrats. När jag handlar på ICA frågar ingen om jag vill betala digitalt. Tvärtom är det numera ovanligt med kontanter och jag förutsätts kunna betala med kort eller med Swish. Det går fortare i kassan. Jag slipper stå länge i kö. Och jag får en bättre överblick av mina inköp. Digitaliseringen av butiker och affärssystem har effektiviserat hela verksamheten och gjort det lättare för användaren av tjänsterna. För oss, konsumenterna. Det är dags för ett stort språng. Vi har redan provat alla former av stöpning av stearinljus. Det ger oss ingen glödlampa. Vi kommer inte vidare i den takt vi skulle behöva. Vi ser fortfarande det digitala som något särskilt, som något avvikande, som en egen gren, en egen kompetensprofil. Vi lägger ihop saker som IT, samlingsförvaltningssystem, digitala visningar, digitala utställningar, webbutveckling och sociala medier till samma sak. Och ibland anställer vi till och med en och samma person till att hantera dessa helt olika saker. En digital person. Den digitala transformationen är svår. Den är krävande. Utmanande och tvingar oss att tänka nya tankar. Men vi måste ta oss igenom den nu. Vi måste sluta benämna det digitala som avvikande, som är registrering och digital registrering. Som utställning och digital utställning. Som visning och digital visning. Som museimöte och digitalt museimöte. Vi behöver se det digitala som normal museiverksamhet. Att det är normalt att kunna boka visningar på internet och inte behöva ringa museet på speciella telefontider. Att det är normalt att intendenter delar med sig av sin kunskap på Wikipedia. Att museets uppdrag inte är begränsat till sina 4 väggar som så få människor ändå kan ta sig till. Uppdragen för museerna är ju i många fall att berätta, förmedla och diskutera historia och kulturarv med utgångspunkt i sina samlingar. Jag tycker själv att det är oerhört viktigt att vi i museibyggnaderna erbjuder utställningar, visningar och pedagogisk verksamhet. Men jag förstår inte varför vi begränsar oss själva så. Vi kan vara så mycket mer. Få andra verksamheter har samma möjligheter som vi har med de fantastiska samlingar som vi förvaltar och med all den kunskap som vi har. Vi kan göra skillnad för människor. Varje gång vi pratar om att vi behöver berätta, förklara, övertyga allmänheten och våra uppdragsgivare om hur viktigt det är med digitalt kulturarv, protesterar jag. Vi är redan förbi det. Det tåget har redan gått. Det är inte de andra som behöver övertygas. Det är vi själva. Tack.
Tack så mycket, Karin. Jag tror redan att det blir en klassiker i museumets digitala uppladdningar på YouTube senare, tror jag. Tack så mycket, och jag hoppas verkligen att vi kan standardisera det här, att vi inte pratar om ett digitalt museumöte, men att det är den nya standarden. Eller inte ens nya.
Inte ens nytt.
Du tog upp en punkt som jag tänkte var väldigt intressant, för att vi uppskattar inte tillräckligt mycket de anställda som faktiskt jobbar med digitala frågor, som till exempel samlingsförvaltning, sociala medier, som är så olika uppgifter och som kräver också så olika kompetenser. Ja. Vad tycker du, vilken typ av människor behöver vi också i den här sektorn, och hur skulle museerna behandla dem?
Jag tycker att Jonas från Statens museum för konst svarade bra på den frågan. Det handlar först och främst om ledarskap, där man behöver se bredden på de personerna som arbetar inom verksamheten. Det mesta hänger ihop. Mm. De digitala inre strukturerna och de yttre strukturerna hänger ihop. Det är ingen idé att ha en intern struktur som inte kommer användarna till del. Men det går heller inte att enbart jobba utåt med digitala visningar, till exempel. Jag tror att vi behöver på riktigt en transformation där vi ser, om vi tar det här exemplet med att det är få museer där man kan boka en biljett, till exempel. Det finns inte ens digitala bokningssystem på museerna. Och jag tror att vi behöver en bredd, på samma sätt som att vi har massor med personer, i alla fall ett flertal på många museer, som jobbar med analog verksamhet, så behöver vi samma flertal som jobbar med digital eller bara olika aspekter av samma verksamhet.
Jättebra, tack så mycket. Vi fick faktiskt en fråga från publiken, men den är så intressant att jag faktiskt ska ställa det till hela panelen. Så jag välkomnar tillbaka också Aron, Jonas och Chao till panelen. Och då tar vi upp den första frågan. Welcome back, Chao, Jonas and Aron. I'm really looking forward to our discussion now. And I'm going to take up the first question from the audience that I think is really worth talking about. If we talk about, for example, digital guided tours or digital exhibitions, these are, at most of them are today, gratis. They are for free. Thanks, Karin. I think we have to talk about business models. How can museums actually make their digital offers to the audience sustainable through new ways of financing them? What do you guys think? Do you want to start?
I think that, as Malin Grundberg said yesterday, we are charging for guide tours at Livrustkammaren. Mm-hmm. And I think you're correct. I think we need to change the way we think about these kind of questions. And I think that we need to change our mindset. And if we do that, we will be able to do anything. And it just doesn't have to be just one thing. It can be anything. We just have to change our way of thinking.
Thank you very much. Jonas, I know that we had in the preparation for this session already some heated discussions about business models. Do you want to jump in with a perspective?
It's not easy, but I think the pressure towards self-financing through selling tickets makes it even harder to do this. Because currently the model that we have implemented and the model that we're sort of pushed towards is entrance fees, right? So I think many things have to change. There's a mindset, but there's also a sort of reward model that I think is important to revise, because currently I think we're pushed towards optimizing visitor numbers, meaning analog visitor numbers, in an unhealthy way. So there has to be some kind of political general reward for our digital work in order for it to go much further, I think.
You took up the question of visitor numbers, something that I know that Aron and Nordiska Museet are really passionate about. Aron, what do you think? How do we have to change our perception as museums and cultural heritage institutions when it comes to the people who actually use our offers, who come to our physical buildings, but also take part in, for example, campaigns such as yours?
I think what we need to return to in this discussion is scarcity, because that is the main difference between the physical and the digital realm. What is scarce? Because that is what you pay for. And we are so used to the buildings being the blocking factor. You pay to get into the building because once it's full, you can't let more people in. And that's not the case on the internet, which is why we have such a hard time figuring out how to charge. And I think we need to return and consider that the people working in the museums, that is the scarcity. So people will pay to get access to us if we have something good to deliver. But it's the people in the museums that are the scarce resource, not the collections published online, or the digitized images, or the recorded videos. Those are not scarce, and we cannot charge for that in itself. We need to add the human factor, and then people will pay.
The human factor, what a nice way of putting it. When we talk about people, actually, and we've already taken up management and its role in digital transformation and the new skill sets that we need, what do you think? Who are we actually missing out when it comes to bringing in new skill sets? What are the gaps when we look at our own staff members? Chao, what would you think? How should we diversify also our own staff in museums, and why do we actually really need to?
I think there are many ways to answer that question. And if I look at, for example, the context of Kenya, one of the things that we saw was that it wasn't that there were no IT departments in the museums. It was an IT department to handle networking and website security. But in terms of engagement and curation, digital curation, there was a very clear distinction between these are the curators and these are the people who are doing IT, you know? And I think we need to start looking at even like curators and people who engage with audiences as needing digital skills, as needing to be on digital platforms. And one of the things that came up in the training was that a lot of the people who we worked with who were either interns or curators or people who were managing collections said, we didn't think these skills apply to us. We thought that, you know, if you haven't studied computer science or if you haven't studied IT, then you have no business, you know, trying to be in this digital space. And I think we really need to expand the definition of that. And I think that's why creating the, training programs for people who are already in museums is quite crucial, because there's a bit of like an apprehension towards it, because they're like, oh, I'm too old to do this, or I didn't learn this in school, so it's not my thing, you know. So being able to communicate even with the staff who are in museums or in archives and who already established that digitals, they can apply digital skills within their practice, not necessarily having to wait for people who've done it before or that they see themselves as needing these skills. And I think the next thing would probably be looking at, but this is tied to funding again, because if like the museums and archives, particularly in Kenya, are not very well funded, so they don't hire staff quite regularly. And what this means is that staff stay maybe 10, 15 years without even hiring, you know, a different generation of staff. So trying to accommodate a younger generation within the museum systems, I think, could play a big part in expanding audience numbers and visitor numbers. Because currently, the majority of people visiting, let's say the museum here in Nairobi, are either school children or tourists. Yeah, most of my friends say we've only been to the museum once and they won't go back, and that's when they were in primary school. So how do you make the museum a relevant space, an active space that you come back to over and over again? I think that could have a huge potential in reaching new audiences also.
Yeah. Thank you, Chao. I want to take up a metaphor that Jonas actually brought up earlier in his session. So in an ideal world, your systems work together, creating a super system. When we think about the museum sector, this is actually true as well. Should museums as subsystems work together in a better way? What do you think, Karin?
Yes, of course. I think that we should work together in a much better way than we do. I think that we should work closer together among the centralmuseer than the sector I represent, the sector in Sweden, among libraries and archives and museums, and globally. I think we will be able to reach much further than we are at the moment. And I think that one of the problems that we are discussing is that we don't really know the value of what we do. We are thinking that that if we create something that people like, then they will like us. I think they already do. I think that culture and the cultural heritage is a part of everyone. And I think that most people know that. I don't think that we need to tell people that. We just have to focus on do good things, and then people will use them. And I think everything will be fine.
Wow, what an optimism in these times. I don't know when I've heard that the last time. I would like to pass on the question to you, Chao. From your perspective, how do you perceive corporations on a global scale? What do museums here in Europe have to make better when seeking out for corporations?
Oh, wow. Okay, I think my perspective is a little bit different because I work on the periphery of the museum. Yeah, so I'm not exactly in a museum, but I work with museums, and I often see that they can be very clunky in terms of bureaucracy. And I think trying to streamline the partnership process, maybe I'd speak maybe for, let's say, museums here, that looking at having institutional policies towards partnership, or actively looking for partnership with other museums. So try and reduce on the bureaucracies a little bit. But I do think there's a lot of potential, even as we look at the concept of democratization and globalization. And, you know, when we talk about a universal museum is not just a museum that has objects from everywhere. I think a universal museum is a museum that has connections and networks and dialogue. You know, this idea that you just have to hold the objects and that makes you a universal museum. I think that's quite naive. If you don't have connections, if you don't have dialogues, if you're not working actively to look at the connections with the people and the connections with the objects. So I mean, it might not be the best answer to the question because again, I'm not within the museum, but I would say that the potential to have more international collaborations, more cross-sectoral collaborations could really play a big role in bringing in new audiences and understanding of each other, you know, the other rather, yeah.
But even if you're not working for a museum, I just want to make sure that you know that we really value your perspective, because I think we need more people from the outside actually giving us feedback as museums. You talked about democratization, and I want to take up a question from the presentation of Chao. You said that digital is actually, in its basics and or in its original idea, a truly democratic place. But when it comes to museums and digital heritage, is that actually true? Is digital a democratic place? We got another question from the audience earlier that I want to take up now. Do we actually have to talk about digital skills in the audience when we're actually producing more and more digital offers to our audience? Do we have to make sure that they can actually use it? Maybe Aaron, you can say something about this with the perspective of the Minden campaign.
Yes, it might have been in the chat I answered that I don't see digital skills as the main barrier, but maybe that is still a bit naive from my position when looking at the Swedish situation. I think it's more important to focus on why people would like to contribute and making sure that our digital initiatives are relevant to the people we are trying to reach. But of course, there are maybe not in digital skills, but rather in access to digital infrastructure. There are big differences in society. Who has availability to high-speed internet? That will impact who can do our 3D tours or whatever we decide to do. Access to printers, access to computers at home and at school, and all of that, of course, will impact who can be a part of our digital offerings. So maybe we need to nuance it a bit more than just caring about the motivations. Of course, there will be barriers. And as Chao pointed out, as soon as you start talking about international barriers, it's a huge difference. We are kind of in, as a Swedish citizen, I am very privileged being able to get a visa for almost any country in the world. And that is not the common case. That is the exception. And there, I think, just like you said, Chao, that open access is a really important way to bring down that barrier as much as we can.
Absolutely. When we talk about openness, such as you just pointed out, I would also like to take up the discussion about restitution, because digital can play a fundamental role in restitution processes. And I know that Chao and African Digital Heritage have just recently launched a new project called Open Restitution. And I would maybe like to talk about you first. What is your perspective on how we can actually make sure that our digital resources even target international audiences who actually might have a totally different connection to the collections that we hold in our collections?
It's a really hard question. I think that I don't think there is a solution. That's one thing I think. Another thing I was thinking of when Aaron answered the last question is that I think that we have a responsibility at the museums to talk about these kind of things. And I think that I don't think there is a solution, but we need to keep talking about it. And we need to keep talking about it globally. And I think that might be the solution, just to talk about it. But then I just wanted to add one small thing as well. And it is that about the 3D tours, and that we have a responsibility to make sure that people have digital skills or not, if we don't have that responsibility. And I think that we have that kind of responsibility as citizens of the world, but not at the museums. I don't think that we can make sure that everyone can receive what we are producing at the museums. And I think it's an important question to talk about that as well. What do we have to do, and what do other people have to do, and what do we have to do as a society and as museums?
Absolutely. Chao, what is your perspective on this?
I think one of the things that I've come to appreciate is when you look at, particularly at restitution and what it means, restitution is not just about return, yeah? I think the word restitution is much more. It's a complex process. There's dialogue, there's understanding, there's reintegration. There's so much involved in restitution that it goes beyond simply returning artifacts or returning objects. I'll give an example of this. A couple of months ago, I came across this collection that was digitized by the Ethnographical Museum of Sweden. I hope I've gotten it right. And it was a collection of recordings from 1919, or I think. 1904 or something from a Kenyan community who are just singing. So the recordings were made available on open access, and I shared them on Twitter, and the response was overwhelming. People were saying, I'm crying listening to this. This is a perspective I never thought I'd have. And I think mostly what needs to be understood is while these recordings and these artifacts were moving out, they were not being, a lot of contextual information and cultural heritage was being erased here. So for us as a younger generation, we found ourselves in this void where we want to go back, but we don't know where to go. And we want to move forward, but we need what we need this information to move forward. So looking at an example of those recordings, those Kenyan recordings held in Sweden and the impact that they had here in Kenya, actually sent them to someone and she said, my grandmother recognizes some of these songs. We are listening to them together. She said she hasn't heard these songs in a while, you know. So looking at the human connection, that these objects, these recordings, these archives, they have a very personal connection to people. And restitution in itself is much more than returning. It has implications on identity. It has implications on future. It has implications on self-worth. You know, there are many other things that are involved within restitution that go beyond return or possession. Yeah.
Thank you, Chao. One aspect that Karin just took up and that I would like to give as a last question to Jonas. I know that you at SMK have a lot of projects that involve citizens, for example, in Wikimedia, hackathons or editathons. You take your digital art to places that are really uncommon, for example, for drug users, places and so on. So what kind of role do citizens and our society actually play in opening up museums? And is it just about the audience? Are we talking still about the audience, or is it more like a community?
Well, it's all about the audience. So they play this sort of the central role in everything we do. The question is when and how to sort of engage audiences. And I think I don't have a sort of a one sentence answer. I just think museums, the problem for museums is usually not that they don't share enough with either audiences or other museums. The problem is that some museums sometimes have a very unrealistic, we do too sometimes, we get caught up in this wild idea, an unrealistic idea of what the public, the audience, the guests want to engage in. They do want to engage in certain things, a lot of things they don't want to engage in at all, but we have a hard time telling the difference sometimes. Like I can sort of sense this. We sometimes say, oh, it would be fun for the audience to do this. But what we mean is it would be great for us if it were fun to do for the audience, but it's not, right? So I think that is a very common problem that we certainly have as well. We have quite a few successful sort of engagement initiatives, and we have quite a few unsuccessful ones as well. And there's an interesting analysis to be done to separate those two.
Thank you so much, Jonas. And I think something that you, Karin, and you, Jonas, just said, there are no one-line answers. There might be some questions that we don't have any answers to, actually. But I think as a whole sector, we have to grow into being open about these gaps in our knowledge. We should not only share the best practices when a project was really successful, but we should share when projects are actually, they were not working at all, or the audience didn't like them at all. So I thank you three there joining us through Zoom, and Karin, you here in the studio, to having joined us today. Jag avrundar sessionen nu och tackar för mig. Det var jätteroligt att diskutera det här ämnet med er och deltagarna. Och jag hoppas att vi kan fortsätta konversationen till exempel på sociala medier med hashtaggen museimöte. Och då går jag tillbaka mikrofonen och koncentrationen till Jeanette.
Tack Larissa och stort tack till panelen och inte minst stort tack till er som har lyssnat och ställt värdefulla frågor från chatten. Nu är det snart dags för lunchpaus mellan 11.45 till 13.00. Under lunchpausen finns det möjlighet till lunchchatt i små grupper för er som har anmält er till att delta. Efter lunchen kan man välja att delta på programpunkten att nå längre och möta alla på andras sätt. Museer, aktörer som har valt att arbeta mer strategiskt med webben. Eller på publika möten med fysisk distans. Hur möter vi publiken under rådande omständigheter? Avslutande seminarier, möten på dagen, blir museum plus näringsliv. Är det lika med sant? Om hur museer och företag kan hitta hållbara former för samarbeten i framtiden. Eller så kan ni lyssna på att ge liv åt en ruin utan att bli ruinerad.